Okay, let's keep going. Before the break, we talk about the diffusion. So there's the passive transport, the one does not require ATP. Let's look at one example. So this diffusion, this movement happens a lot in your digestive system. When you feel hungry, you eat a donut. So let's see how to move this donut into your body, from the outside into your body. And after you eat the donut, your digestive system is going to cut into the small molecule. The small molecule include the lipid and also have ions. You put salt into it and also the sugar. And the lipid part is the easy one, like we talk about cholesterol. Cholesterol is the molecule can use simple diffusion, moves through the cell membrane because the cell membrane is made of phospholipid. But the other two parts, the ions, the sugars, okay, the ions, well, they are small, but they're charged, so they need ion channel. We call it channel-mediated diffusion, facilitated diffusion. They need ion channel to make them go through. How about the sugar? Let's look at sugar. So the sugars are the energy source of carbohydrate. So this is carbohydrate. And your digestive system cut it to the simple sugar and this glucose. And glucose is still too big to use simple diffusion to go through the cell membrane, and you need glucose carrier. So we have two famous glucose carrier, GLUT2 and GLUT4. And one of them is insulin sensitive. GLUT4 is insulin sensitive. And let's look at the glucose carrier. So the glucose, your cells need glucose. So that's the outside, that's the inside. And after you eat a big meal, okay, this glucose, they are ready to go into the cell. And they are too big to go through the cell membrane. That's why you need to put the glucose carrier. You need the glucose carrier there. And now you eat a big meal, you have a lot of sugar surrounded outside. And you want them to quickly go from the outside to the inside. So you put glucose carriers on it, and this glucose carrier, they still follow the concentration gradient. They still go from the high glucose into the low glucose area. So they still go from high to low. After they move in, well, you found the inside, you have more sugar, and that's a problem because now the concentration gradient starts to decrease, and the molecule won't move when there's no concentration gradient. And the strategy the cell use is after the glucose move inside, they will put a phosphate group, like put a stamp on it, and it becomes G6P. After you put the phosphate group on it, this molecule is not glucose anymore, it's G6P. And if you still remember, you found this is the first step for glycolysis. So after the cells take glucose in, they're going to turn to the G6P, they're going to go through glycolysis, citric acid cycle, electron transport chain to turn into ATP. Yeah, this is the first step. That's why they put into the turn to the G6P. And after it turns to the G6P, it's not glucose anymore. So the glucose inside concentration remains low. And outside still high, so it can keep going into the cell. But there's another problem. These glucose carriers is like the UT shuttle. If you think about UT shuttle, it's pretty easy to understand. Okay, if it's not during the rush hour, the UT shuttle, every 20 minutes, they come one shuttle, and the students, there are 10, 20 students waiting there, they get into the bus. That's good enough. But during the rush hour, after 5 p.m., everybody want to go home. And you found, well, there are so many students, hundreds of students sometimes, waiting for the bus to come. And apparently, UT have a strategy. They know, okay, they're going to have more students need the shuttle to transport them. And their strategy is they increase the shuttle number during the rush hour. So sometimes every 10 minutes, every 5 minutes. And sometimes you found, oh, there are two shuttles waiting there. They increase the shuttle. And that's the strategy your body use. You have the glucose carrier. You have the GLUT2. You have GLUT4. The GLUT4 is insulin sensitive. So after you eat a big meal, you have a lot of blood sugar. This high blood sugar is going to trigger GLUT4. So they can trigger the insulin release. And insulin, after it's been released, its function is to ask the cell, mainly the muscles, and also the adipose cells, the fat cells. So the main target for the insulin is the skeletal muscle, because you have so many skeletal muscles all over your body. And they will put more GLUT4 on the cell membrane. it's like you put more UT shuttle. So even though you have a lot of sugar in your blood, but they put more glucose carrier, like they put more shuttles to carry those students. So turn out the glucose blood sugar level can quickly move in and lower the blood sugar. And that's the function of insulin. And now you can think, okay, if this person's insulin system is not functioning well, what's the problem? A lot of glucose waiting outside. Like a lot of students, they're waiting for the shuttle to come. The shuttle is still not coming. Okay, well, they're all packed here. High blood sugar. And that's diabetes. So diabetes, we have diabetes 1 and diabetes 2. Diabetes 1 is genetic. They're short of insulin. So it's their body, their immune system is autoimmune disease. Their immune system, their immune cells, they're supposed to be able to use the glycoprotein, like the protein we just talked about before the break, to identify, okay, this is your body cells, leave it alone, that's not your body cells, attack the bad guy. And they make a mistake. They look at the beta cells in the pancreas, they say, they look suspicious, let's attack them. So the immune system attack all the beta cells in the pancreas, and the beta cells in the pancreas, they're supposed to release insulin. So that's diabetes. So diabetes 1, the patient you found, they have to self-inject insulin every meal, after every meal, because their body don't have insulin anymore. And that's when usually they identified, they found it when they were pretty young. And that's when you watch the TV, you found some kids, they have to learn to use self-inject insulin when they were pretty small, and every time break your heart when you see that. And that's diabetes 1. Diabetes 2 is insulin insensitivity. Diabetes 2 is your body have insulin and have too much insulin. And the reason is environment. So we call it nature and nurture. So diabetes 1 is nature. It's the gene. Diabetes 2 is nurture. It's the environment caused. It's like every day you just pour your body with a lot of glucose. And this glucose is going to trigger insulin release. And when you have so many insulin, these cells become less and less sensitive to insulin. It's like, okay, the husband and the wife, if every day the wife just keep yelling at the husband, eventually the husband ignore the yelling. He will pretend he did not hear it. He just watch TV, right? And that's diabetes 2. Diabetes 2 is you eat a lot of carbohydrates. Due to their body just consume too much carbohydrate. And it happens a lot in the 21st century because you eat hamburger, you drink soda, so we have nothing good to say about soda, that sugar water, and just saturate this system. Their body releases too much insulin. And eventually this body become insensitive to insulin. These cells, they're supposed to put GLUT4 on it, and it become insensitive. It put less GLUT4 on it. So what could the pancreas do? The only thing it can do is it pump more insulin. And this word cycle just keep going. Eventually, the body become insensitive to insulin, and that's about diabetes 2. So diabetes 2 patients, usually they don't self-inject insulin because their body insulin level is three times higher than normal, and that's diabetes 2. So diabetes 2 patients have to watch the sugar they eat. And before they have diabetes 2, they have years of insulin insensitivity. High insulin. That's why when you do your annual health check, you have to test your blood sugar level when you're fasting. Ideally, your blood sugar level should be pretty low. The lower the better after you fasted. And your insulin level should be pretty low when you're fasted. It tells you your system is very sensitive to insulin. That's good. And 90% of diabetes are diabetes 2. Okay, so that's the story of glucose carrier. So diffusion, we talk about those diffusion. So the diffusion, does it require energy? Yes, you need to give them something, kinetic energy, temperature, concentration, gradient. So no energy, no movement. But does diffusion require ATP? The answer is no biological energy. So the energy comes from the concentration gradient. And what's the factor effect diffusion rate? Well, temperature, because when you increase the temperature, the molecule gonna move faster. So temperature can affect diffusion rate, molecular size, smaller molecules move faster than the bigger molecule. And distance, diffusion works pretty well for short distance. Like your neighbor fart and you smell it, right? And I suffer less because I'm pretty far away. And your nephew live in New York suffer from nothing because, well, it's too far away. So diffusion works pretty well for short distance, not for the long distance. And when does diffusion stop? When there's no concentration gradient. When there's no concentration gradient, no movement. And also other factors like surface area, you need to have big surface area, thickness, because the short distance diffusion works pretty well. So application, when we talk about in the respiratory system, your lung, the oxygen need to use simple diffusion to go from your lung, those air bubble, we call the alveoli. So you have millions of alveoli in your lung. And then they need to use simple diffusion to go from your lung to your blood. If your lung shrink, it turns out the diffusion is going to decrease because you need big surface area. So the lung total surface area of your lung is like the half tennis court. It's about 1,200 square feet. And they help diffusion. And also there are other diseases increase the thickness of the alveoli wall, like the fibrotic lung disease, turn the lung tissue into scar tissue. They all, both of them compromise diffusion. So diffusion depends on all this, lipid solubility, surface area, membrane thickness, and the fix, you put the low, you put all these parameters together, so you call the fixed low. Fixed low is diffusion rate, depends on numerator, depends on these three. So surface area, big surface area, the better. Bigger concentration gradient, the better. No concentration gradient, no movement. Also permeability, if this molecule is made of lipid, increased permeability, or you can open the ion channel, increased permeability if it's not made of lipid. That's for ion, so permeability. And denominator, that's the membrane thickness. So you increase the membrane thickness, it's actually the worst part. Now let's look at those membrane proteins. Some molecules, they need to go through the cell membrane. And they could not use simple diffusion. They need to use facilitated diffusion. And we can use the ion channel, we can use carrier. These two are structurally they're different. So this is the ion channel, this is carrier. So you can tell the difference. So ion channel, they provide the opening of these two, direct opening. So you found you could not make this hole too big because it can damage the cell. So for the bigger molecule, they have to use the carrier. Carrier, they don't have a direct connection of these two. So let's look at the ion channel. So this is the ion channel. These ion channels, they provide the opening from the outside extracellular fluid and the inside intracellular fluid. So the cells inside, outside are water. It provides the opening. And these channels, apparently if they open for too long, it can compromise the environment of the cell because the ECF and ICF, their environment are different. So most of the time they are closed. They are closed. If you need to open them, you need to use a different mechanism to open them. So it depends on how you open them. We have three different categories. We have the voltage-gated, mechanically-gated, and ligand-gated ion channel. So it depends on how to open them, we put them into these three different categories. Voltage-gated ion channel, they sense the voltage. So that when they have the voltage change, they are able to open them. So when we talk about the neurons, we'll talk about the voltage-gated ion channels. And mechanically-gated ion channel, the name tells you there's the mechanical force to push them open and close. A good example is in your inner ear. In your inner ear, you have the hair cells. When the sounds come, you can vibrate the eardrum, and you can vibrate the three ossicles. Ossicles are the smallest bone you have in your body. So each one of them is smaller than 0.5 centimeter, and they're in your middle ear. They're gonna push the movement from the eardrum into the inner ear. And in the inner ear, you have hair cells, and these hair cells are gonna vibrate. When they vibrate on the hairs, they have the mechanically gated ion channel. So when they move to one direction, they're going to open. When they move to the other direction, they're going to close. So they're able to open, close the mechanically gated ion channel. Let's take a break.